What's up everybody? Welcome to today's video where I'm going to be talking to you a little bit about vegetarianism and how vegetarianism impacts the planet. Now, just as a disclaimer, I am not here to preach to you about the best way to live your life, but I do think that people should be able to make informed choices by having all of the information in front of them. I also fully support sustainable family farming. So this is one thing that I think gets often lost in the debate, where people feel like if you are a vegetarian or if you eat less meat, you don't support farmers. I think that is untrue. It's definitely untrue for me. I think that there are amazing traditional and natural ways that we can continue to farm, but in a more sustainable way. And the reality is that as things stand, farming is not sustainable. I just want you to have all the facts in front of you so that you can make a really, really informed decision about whether reducing meat or eating no meat at all is an approach that you would like to take in order to reduce your carbon footprint. So if you do like this video, please don't forget to give it a big thumbs up, and also please don't forget to hit subscribe, which is that big red button down below, so that you don't miss any more of my videos. So there is an absolute wealth of information out there as to why a vegetarian diet can be so beneficial. But I really want to focus on the climate aspect of that today. And I got really, really interested in this after a program aired on our national broadcaster, RTE, called What Planet Are You On? And the diet expert in that show is called Marco Springmann. And he is a senior researcher in population health, and his entire focus in that series was to encourage people to eat less meat on a day-to-day basis so that they could reduce their carbon footprint. And if you don't know what your carbon footprint is, it is essentially the amount of carbon that you emit by just doing your normal day-to-day activities. So how much electricity you use, whether you own a car, how much driving you do, whether you use gas to heat your home, how much plane travel you take. There are a whole host of different factors that combine together to create your carbon footprint. And if you are looking for a great website to calculate that, I would go to the World Wildlife Fund website, and I will leave a link to that in the description box below so that you can calculate your own carbon footprint and kind of make an assessment as to where you could make some improvements to bring that number down. Marco really encouraged me to look more into this. I think the academic side of me was awakened again by all the scientific studies that he has been a part of, that he has spearheaded, and that provide genuine facts as to why a vegetarian diet is better for combating climate change and making sure that we meet our carbon targets. And that is one thing that I would like you to note about this video. I am not just spouting facts at you from random places. Everything I will tell you in this video is backed up by scientific studies. And every time I mention something to you, I will leave a link to that source in the description box so you can do more research yourself if that's something that you want to do. So I just want to read you some statistics which you might find a little bit shocking. Today's agricultural system is incredibly resource intensive, which I'm sure you can imagine. Covering 43% of the world's ice and desert-free land. Of this land, 87% is for food and 13% is for biofuels and textile crops, or is allocated to non-food uses such as wool and leather. Those are some quite scary numbers. So we can already see that the agricultural system that is in place right now worldwide is not doing the planet any favors. So how does vegetarianism feed into this? Well, it feeds into this because the majority of food-related emissions is actually related to livestock production. So animals like cattle, like sheep, like pigs. At a global level, more than 3/4 of the world's emissions are related to animal agriculture, and that is really frightening, and it's actually quite high in Ireland because we are an economy that is focused largely on agriculture and largely on dairy and beef farming. But you might wonder why animals produce such high emissions, and there are a couple of reasons for this. One of them being that animals are really poor converters of the energy or the food that they take in into body mass. So it actually takes between 10 and 50 kilos of grain for a cow to produce just 1 kilo of meat. That's 1 kilo. 50 kilos of food, 1 kilo of meat. That really is such a poor ratio of energy in versus energy out. And this is such a serious discrepancy because if you think about it, all of that grain has to be grown. So that grain needs fertilizer, it needs space. So a lot of the times we're experiencing deforestation because we need to plant more grains to feed these animals. There is an enormous amount of water that goes into producing the grain and also an enormous amount of water that goes into keeping that animal alive throughout its lifetime. And another really concerning aspect of growing grain is that fertilizers need to be used. Because of the sheer volume and quantity and speed at which we need to grow grain to feed animals, to feed humans. And a dangerous greenhouse gas called nitrous oxide is produced, similar to carbon dioxide, which is the common greenhouse gas. Another reason that the emissions related to animal production are so high is simply because of the characteristics or composition of these animals. So if you didn't know about the composition of sheep and cows, it's actually quite interesting. They have one large stomach, which is broken up into four compartments. These animals are called ruminants, and having these four stomachs makes them really, really efficient at taking nutrients from grass, something that humans are quite poor at. But because they are trying to break down things like grass and hay and other plants that are found in the natural environment, they produce a lot of gas. Similar to ourselves, if your stomach does not like you when you eat too much spinach or leafy greens, I'm one of those people. And it sounds a little bit crazy, but actually when these animals are digesting their food, they are producing a greenhouse gas called methane, probably more often associated with cattle than with sheep or other ruminant animals. And this is another really kind of crazy statistic that I'd like to read you. When it comes to cows, there is in fact so much burping going on that the methane emissions that are generated in the process contribute well over a third, 39% to be precise, of all livestock emissions. And that comes from a study called Tackling Climate Change Through Livestock. And it's one that I would encourage you to at least have a look at the executive summary of, because there are some crazy statistics in there. So we can see it's not just about the feed that the animal needs to live. It's not just about the water. It's actually about the gases that are produced by the animals themselves, which is incredibly problematic, not in small numbers, not in a small sustainable family farm situation, but in these mass production arenas, essentially, that we have going on in order to feed mass amounts of people and fill that demand. So it really comes down to recognizing that changing your diet is one of the most efficient and effective ways that we can reduce carbon emissions and the greenhouse gases that are reaching our environment. And I do want to talk about this in a completely separate video on plant-based proteins themselves, but the emissions that are associated with producing plant-based proteins like beans and peas and lentils are almost 100 times lower than those that are associated with animal production. And the reality is that without dietary changes, we are not going to meet our climate targets. And you might say, well, what difference is one person going to make? Well, I believe in the power of one. I believe in the power of a family to make much wider changes. And the reason being is that society is based on supply and demand. It's basic economics. So if we stop eating meat, we stop consuming animal products as much as we currently are, then that means the need for production lessens and lessens. So you can opt for meals maybe once or twice a week, like a sweet potato and chickpea curry or a lentil stew. There are so many amazing and cheap vegetarian options out there. So the answer is to just make small changes where you can to understand how animal agriculture is impacting the environment. And I'm really glad that I can talk about these kind of topics on my channel. I really am looking forward to talking more about the benefits of a plant-based diet and bringing you more zero-waste meal options for a plant-based lifestyle. And I just want to say thank you so much for watching as always. And if you like the video, please do give it a big thumbs up and hit subscribe so that you don't miss any more of my videos. And with that said, I'm looking forward to seeing you in my next video. Bye!